The topic for tonight, three ways that great leaders manage and resolve conflicts. And where I want to start this off with is this slide and concept that we call in the 10. And by in the 10, we mean, around 10% of life generally is stress. It's difficult. We're being challenged. It's intense. It may be a conflict with someone. And, in leadership roles, and that applies to everyone because everyone is a leader, whether you think you are or not, whether it's a friend, a family member, child, a colleague, this always applies. So in the 10% of life, when it's challenging, that's when we're being tested. That's when it can be hard to even reach a resolution. It can be hard to find some common ground if you're in a conflict with someone. But it's also in the 10% of life where we find all of our growth, all of our lessons. It's how we improve. It's how we get better. We don't grow in the 90 when life is easy. It's easy to be new you. It's easy to think a new thought. It's easy to apply a new tool. When it's easy, it's a little bit more challenging in the 10 and in conflict moments. The metaphor I've always loved is races aren't won in a tailwind. Everyone's going as fast as the wind is blowing in a tailwind. It's only in the headwinds where how well you cut the sail and how well you manage and deal with the adversity is what wins the race. So it's very, very important as a leader, being conscious of these in the 10 moments to, show up differently, show up new, apply one of these new tools that I'm going to be giving you here tonight. And remember, keep in mind that when you're presented with a conflict, it's this opportunity. It's an opportunity for growth. It's an opportunity to maybe even strengthen a relationship. We have a saying here that legendary relationships require legendary, you guessed it, conflicts. Now, it can't just stop there. You can't just have conflicts all the time. Because with that is legendary conflict resolution. And that's what we're focused on tonight, some resolution strategies. But it really starts in, keeping this and staying firm, trusting this process that, less conflicts isn't really the goal. That's not what we're after. This webinar, these tools, isn't about how do you have less conflicts. Really, it's more of the flip side, because if less conflicts is your outcome, is your intention, well, guess what? You don't get the lessons, you don't get the growth, you don't get those opportunities. So, welcome the opportunity. Get excited about the opportunity. And this is a moment for you to show up as a leader, show up differently with someone. So that's rule number one. Now, I said in the email too, I was going to give you the basis of really 99, and you could argue all arguments and conflicts, is simply this. And a lot of times we hear, when we ask clients or ask an audience, what's the source of your conflict or arguments, we might hear communication problems, we're not communicating well. Maybe it's you just, I don't like the other person. lots of different reasons that you'll hear. Communication problems is probably the most common, but that's not really true. A lot of times, most of the time, you're communicating very, very well. It's just that what's being communicated is I'm right and you're wrong. And yeah, I'll listen to your point and I'll wait till you're done so I can tell you why you're wrong and I'm right. and give you my opinion, give me my thoughts, and I'm just listening and respond. And but you look at these arguments and think to maybe some recent arguments that you've had. Did you have this kind of position? You're just really out to, you know, prove the other person wrong and support your position as to why you're right. Now, we're seeing this so much lately, especially on social media, you know, when it's just text and it's a lot of back and forth, and there's not a healthy discussion, you know, there's not a healthy discord going on. And so underlying a lot of the conflicts out there is this very simple thing. I'm right, you're wrong, you know? And so we have some fun little memes, some quotes, Sheldon, right? Don't you think if I were wrong, I'd know it? But it's important to know that what you're arguing about, the data of the conversation, you know, you may be arguing points for sure, but underlying all of that is this very thing. Now, how do you get around that? It's this very simple tool. And this comes out of our neural communications tools. There's 9 things here. I'm giving you a couple tonight, but this very simple rule: it's better to be kind than it is to be right. You know, if you just take that one simple rule and you live by that, and that's how you approach all of your conflicts, your arguments, I tell you right away, you're going to notice a drastic change in your interactions. If you personally, it doesn't even have to be the other person, get past the, I have to be right, I have to be right, and just listen, just understand, just be kind, just have compassion, you know, empathy. Listen, truly listen, understand what they're talking about. I'll tell you, you could leave this webinar, just do this one thing, and you're already going to greatly improve your leadership skills. And so I wanted to bring this up. I actually was going to save this for last, but I have a bonus tool here. This isn't one of the 3, but this comes out. We have a whole course and program on this, on leadership. And we call this the 6 master steps to lasting change and transformation. But this is the process that we follow when we're coaching with a client, when we're training other people in the system how to be an extraordinary leader. They're expected to know this 6-step process inside and out. And I'm not going to cover it tonight because, again, we could spend days, weeks on just this alone. But if you look at the very first step, discover the deepest truths and patterns and creations of the individual. And right under that, what I'm going to say is going to go with your kind versus right tool. What will help it with that is if you get out of your model of the world and get into theirs and truly understand where they're coming from, their view of the world. Why do they think this way? Why are they saying this to me? Why are they angry right now? Why are they upset? What is the deeper root cause of the issue, you know, of what we're conflicted about? When you really take this position and you're, again, getting out of your model of the world and trying to tell this person all about your model of the world and how you think it should be and your point, and let me tell you even more. No, you don't get it. Let me tell you why I'm right. No, just really get into theirs. Understand their thought patterns. Now, this takes a little bit more training. Again, we go into deeper into this in our Black Belt leadership courses, our 3-day leadership courses, even understanding how do you, because you'll see all these other points. These are some cues for you that allow you to do that. Really understanding a person better than they understand themselves, because maybe they don't even know why they're so upset or angry or, you know, the way that they are or presenting in the conflict. And it's your job as a leader to figure that out, especially when you're not even, let's say, part of the conflict. You're just a mediator. You have to friends, to employees, to kids, whatever the situation is, or even a group larger than just two, a group of people, you're listening for cues, programming cues. You know, how can I reach this person? How can I talk to them at a deeper level? It really starts here. So, you know, letting go of your need to be right, having compassion, having kindness, knowing that that's already going to immediately diffuse a situation, diffuse an intense conflict. And then just, I mean, think about it. When you're kind to someone, they kind of let their guard down, right? You're going to be able to have better rapport with them. You'll connect better. So that was, again, step two, but this will help with this as well. If you just focus on getting into their model of the world, trying to understand them even better. Now, number three, and again, this comes out of our neural communication tools as well. And so you've heard the golden rule, right? It's in many different schools of thought. You know, it many different forms, but generally it comes in the form of treat others the way that you would like to be treated. Now, it sounds nice. It's not a bad rule, but really think about this. Treat others the way you would like to be treated. I just told you, get out of your model of the world, you know, as a great tip. And if you're in your model of the world trying to, you know, treat someone in your model of the world that you would like to be treated and you're not really in their model, yeah, there's some potential challenges that can arise. And let me give you an example of this. So this actually comes out of our legendary relationship work and courses. We cover this as content. It's not ours. It's a great book. It's a very easy, quick read if you ever want to get it. It's the 5 love languages. And here they are: words of affirmation, quality time, receiving gifts, acts of service, and physical touch. So one of the issues that you find, especially in, you know, a romantic relationship, on top of the first rule that I told you, that basis of most arguments is, let me tell you why I'm right and you're wrong. This is another thing, because a lot of times two people aren't speaking the same language. And in a romantic relationship, if let's say my language is words of affirmation, I just want to be told that you love me. I just want you to tell me how awesome I am. Just tell me all these great words of affirmation. If that's what I love, if that's how I feel love, how I receive love, but you know, you or the person I'm interacting with loves to, you know, receive gifts, could come in the form of flowers, you know, necklace, you know, taking you out to a dinner, any kind of gift, if that's your love language, and I'm trying to resolve a conflict, I'm trying to tell you I care about you, I love you, but I'm speaking my language, I'm busy giving you words of affirmation because that's what I think in my model of the world, that's what I want, but I don't really understand. I don't get that you really like to receive gifts. Well, yeah, there's going to be a barrier, a language barrier. I mean, you're not going to feel it as much. So, you know, back to our golden rule, treat others the way that you would like to be treated, or speak to others the way that you want to be spoken to. Yeah, it's not the highest form of the rule that exists. And that's why this is called the pyramid rule or the platinum rule. Do unto others now becomes as they would do unto them. Do unto others as they would do unto them. So again, you're in their model of the world. You know, you're resolving a conflict by, oh, I know that they love acts of service. So, you know, I'm going to do something for them. I'm going to take a job for them. I'm going to do some, you know, work for them. I'm going to take the garbage out, or I'm going to, you know, clean the house up. So you really have to get into the person's model of the world, understand what language they speak, what they like, you know, what drives them, what hurts them, what, you know, maybe it was something that you said that triggered something in their model of the world. Could be, you know, something that their father said to them for a long time, and, you know, they have a terrible relationship with them and you had no idea. But when you really understand either your people, you know, that you're leading, your employees, you should understand your family already very well enough, understand their family of origin. That's probably the easiest place, you know, to lead. But with friends, this is where you really get to have deeper conversations, get beneath the surface level stuff, really understand, you know, tell me about yourself. Like, tell me about your family. Where are you from? What are your dreams? What are your fears? And you don't even have to have a full-blown, you know, model of the world that a lot of you here have done, you know, that 5-page document where ends up being 20 plus pages. Now, you could do that. It's a great thing to do if you are leading a team or you're working with someone one-on-one. You could even do a shortened model of the world, but you can get a lot of this great information as far as the deepest truth patterns creations by just asking awesome questions. You know, having compassion, caring. And again, to recap, so I saw a couple people join in a little bit late. The first rule was, you're a leader. You have to view conflicts as part of the process of creating legendary relationships. It's not about avoiding conflict. By doing that, by avoiding a conflict, well, guess what? Now we can throw in one of our other favorite, a TIY, you know, 101 tool. That's an away pattern. You're avoiding pain. It's an attraction for more pain. It's only going to fester. It's going to grow. It's going to get worse until, you know. So if you have a towards pattern that views conflict as healthy and necessary, and it's an in the 10 moment, it's a intense crisis, you know, the world's testing me, the universe is testing me, I welcome challenge, man. I eat conflicts for breakfast and I love it because I know at the end, because I'm going to be a leader and I'm going to, you know, strengthen this relationship with someone. And man, I just love conflicts. It's not an attraction for conflicts. It's an acknowledgement that, hey, this is all great. You know, not something that you fear or, you know, shy away from or focus on getting less of. You have to own these moments first and foremost. You know, you're not taking the position that most people take, the basis of most arguments, that I'm right and you're wrong. You're practicing kindness. And then do unto others as they would do unto them. Get in their model of the world. Understand them better. So, if you want more of these tools, we're just scratching the surface here. I gave you three things. You know, you saw a glimpse of the six-step model. This is something we go in depth in our leadership course, our Black Belt leadership course. I'm actually starting a new round tomorrow. Now, that doesn't mean you can't join in. It just means we're going to be starting, you know, the process over from going through the system inside and out. So, it's an awesome group. We focus a lot on applying this stuff, on case studies, sharing our own, what's going on in our own leadership journeys. It's a really great group. If you want more, schedule a time with me, go to the website, theinevitableyou.com. There's a new feature on the site now. You can book a time, book 30 minutes with me. I'd love to meet with you, ask any questions that you have. I'll give you all the details. Of course, one-on-one coaching, our bread and butter, always available. And then on a more self-paced kind of thing, we have the Live Life by Design course that's taking you through this process of upgrading your mental software. Starts with the model of the world, understanding who old you is, taking you all the way up to greatest version of you. It's an amazing course. You're going to have an awesome experience just doing that alone. But I know a lot of people, that's a challenging thing to do, and they want more a support of a group, just like we have going here with these webinars and calls. So that's $497 lifetime access. And yeah, again, I would love to talk with you if you have any more questions. And that's where I'll open it up for Q&A for tonight's call. It can be anything about the content covered or anything at all. Anything is fair game. So hope you enjoyed that. What do you got for me? And James and Dave, I know you guys hopped on a little bit late. So if anything needs more, if you want to take another dive on something, feel free. But welcome. Glad you were able to make it. Going once, going twice. Let me check my YouTube channel too. I forgot about that. What do we got? Still learning my way around YouTube here. Not sure if we had any viewers or not, but anything from the group here?
I was just going to
I'm sorry.
Jump in. Can you hear
me? Dave, sorry, I had my speaker turned down a little bit.
Oh, no worries. I was just hopped on here late, and if somebody else could maybe, if you could recap the quick
the three things,
habits. Yeah.
Yeah,
I
know. Did you figure out which
I? Yeah, we could do that again. So first was in the 10. Now you know in the 10, Dave, right?
Sure.
Which is says what?
Always be in the 10.
What is the in the 10?
That's sorry about the rink if there's background noise.
Oh, no problem.
I'm living back at the rink again. Yes, being in the 10, conflict at a 10, resolution at a 10.
Yeah, 10 is the crisis, intense moments of life where you're being tested, you're being challenged. Now, why would I have this one as the number one, the first thing in our leadership conflict management resolution toolbox here? Do you think? And if anyone else wants to hop in and
always looking to operate from that mindset.
Yes. And you can see here on the right, I don't know if you can see my screen. I wrote legendary relationships require legendary conflict. So, trusting the fact that in the 10 is where you grow, you don't grow in the 90. So conflicts are good. Conflicts are healthy. I welcome conflicts. I love this. It's an opportunity for me, opportunity for us, right? So it's, yeah. You can't avoid conflict, which is an away pattern. You can't avoid conflict because then you'd be cheating yourself of all the lessons and growth opportunities that come in the 10. So that was the first rule. And is that making sense?
Absolutely.
Two was our kind versus right tool. It's always better to be kind versus right. And I said, if you take nothing out of this webinar, but this one thing, because the basis of most arguments and conflicts is I'm right and you're wrong. Let me just continue to try to prove to you and argue my position on why I think this thing that we're conflicted about is right and you're wrong. You're not seeking to understand. You're not, you know, approaching the conversation with kindness. And just doing this alone diffuses the situation, diffuses the emotion. You know, you can find things now. Maybe it's, well, if I'm being kind and I'm, you know, seeking to understand, I'm getting in their model of the world. What are the things we can agree on? Right? Where can we find some common ground? Right? Because it's very rarely is it ever about 100%. So this is a good one. Calibration. And the law of the continuum, meaning, you know, here's zero, here's 100, you know, this, what this person's saying, where on this scale do I fall? Is it 100% completely don't agree with, you know, anything that this person is saying? It's very rarely. Now, can we get to, you know, 10%? Here's 10% we agree on. You know, are we just arguing about 90%? Or are we just arguing about 10%, but we're actually in agreement about 90? You know, so using calibration is another great tool. So you can call this maybe number five or six. I don't know how many tools I've thrown out there yet, but just being kind, you know. Let go of just trying to prove your point all the time. Now, there's value to that. I'm not saying never, don't just completely give up on trying to prove a point, but kindness over being right first. Now, the third one was the pyramid rule versus golden rule. I think you hopped on for this one, right? I don't want to go through the entire content again.
Yeah, I came at the end of this one. Sorry.
Oh, no problem. Which was do unto others as they would do unto them. That's where we have our five languages of love as an example. You know, if someone's upset about something, they're, and put it in a relationship context, you know, your spouse is angry at you about something and you're trying to resolve a conflict. Are you trying to speak your language to them and not theirs? That's why, you know, do unto others as you would do unto yourself, or treat others the way you'd like to be treated, isn't the highest form of the rule. You have to be in their model of the world.
Brian, this is Colette.
Hey, Colette.
Can you go down to the five love languages? You know, they do have a test out there on their website that you can take, and it will tell you what percentage of that is is where you would fall. But, you know, just a, also another example, I mean, if your primary love language is words of affirmation, as you have highlighted there, but your spouse's is spending quality time, you could send all the words of affirmation that you want. But if you're not spending time with your spouse, because that's their primary love language, and that's how they know that you love them, or that's what communicates to them that you love them, then your words are just for naught. And if you've got to put the action behind it and spend that quality time with that individual. I mean, and the words of affirmation are nice, but for them, you know, something completely different. And a lot of times I think that's where a lot of conflict comes into play, is when we are trying to, you know, give somebody our own primary love language and it's not theirs.
Right. Exactly right. So this is another reinforcement of, you know, again, not only the platinum rule or pyramid rule, do unto others as they would do unto themselves, but what we're showing here in the six-step model, which I gave as a bonus thing, getting out of your model world into theirs, absolutely crucial. It's actually step zero. If I have another, if I were to make another
always another reminds template. Me of,
what was that?
Always reminds me of quote from, I believe it was Dale Carnegie, the best asset anyone can have is the ability to see the world through someone else's eyes.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, again, and just looking at the interactions that have, the way that things are evolving on social media, over the last, year and a half now, especially, I think that this is really missing, you know? People aren't seeing, they just see it through their own eyes. This is the way that it is, this way I think that it is. And if you don't agree with it, well, now let me lump you in with, you know, half of the population who's one way versus another way. And there's broad generalizations, and then there's a lot of nastiness that occurs, and it just escalates the conflict versus, man, think of just, if just like everyone knew this rule, just this one rule.
That would make a big difference. We'd have a lot less conflict if we could, everybody could do that rule.
Yeah. And you don't have to agree with what the person sees through their model of the world, but you can understand it, you know, understand it better, understand, well, why would this person think that way? Okay. Well, instead of getting angry or getting, you know, nasty and trying to prove a position that way, can I do it with compassion? Can I do it with love? Can I do it with intellect? Can I do it with, you know, other strategies that might be more effective? That's where I, you know, where we see conflict resolution, our legendary conflict resolution strategies. I forgot to make that point up here, Dave, in the 10. Not only does legendary conflict, is it required for legendary relationships? You have to have legendary resolution strategies in place as well. So, you know, these are just a few. the best few, really, as far as tools go here in the system that, that we have for that. So.
Hey, Brian.
Kate.
A plethora of thoughts because I love this discussion. Excuse me. For what it's worth, Kate's philosophy is that we're in a time culturally where we have a lack of emotional maturity, so that a lot of conflict is based on winning and not just having a difference of opinion, but wanting to crush your opponent. That just reminds me of 5 and 6 year old bullies. You know, I mean, it is so emotionally immature, the approach to conflict resolution today. It breaks my heart. And that's a general statement because there are plenty of amazing people who are choosing a different path that start with why they're in a relationship. Because, you know, sometimes they're forced on us, employer, employee, a neighbor. Generally, we don't choose our neighbors. Then the chosen relationships, romantic, or, you know, even a church community, college. There's so many awesome, awesome opportunities to have relationships, but I like to figure out why I'm in the relationship and am I trying to force a harmony that isn't going to happen, but what can happen even if, or should I say and instead of but, what can happen in those relationships that aren't meant to really blend is an art of allowing, respect, acceptance. I wrote down a lot of things of the purpose of a discussion. For me, it starts with who am I having the discussion with, and you know, is the relationship one I'm heavily invested in? Is it a critical relationship? It doesn't matter if I'm having a discussion with my mom about how she cleans the dishes. You know, at some point, you know, you just laugh. She goes to bed and I do them different. So no problem there. But for me, is the purpose of the discussion to influence, to share, to have clarity, to gain clarity, to be understood or to understand, to accept, to honor? And so many of the ones that we're seeing on social media, it's not just conflict, it's a battle. It's a battle based on wanting to win and crush the opponent, which is a very emotional immaturity. And sadly, you know, we have this sense of anonymity, haha, like being in the car and people not knowing your license plate in your car. And, you know, I mean, I'm in a small town now and I put bumper stickers on my car for a reason. I want people to know who I am and what I stand for. And they're meant to be uplifting things, funny things, helpful things, not in your face things. So I just find one of my favorite guys, Dennis Prager, talks about he prefers clarity over agreement. He constantly has people on and interviews them with great respect and great thoughtfulness and kindness. And if he has just diametric difference of opinion with these people, he's respectful and his questions are not to change them, it's to understand them. He is looking for clarity over agreement, knowing that going into the discussion based on a book they've written or a stance that they're taking, that there's probably not going to be agreement. There can certainly be respect and honor and acceptance and allowing and parting ways in a kindness model. So those are my things. I mean, I think the other thing that I find is that when it comes to I'm right and you're wrong, sometimes it's relative and sometimes it's absolute. So there are, for me, absolute truths. I don't have to have anybody agree with me on that. I'm happy to share and discuss and find out why perhaps they don't accept absolute truths, because in today's world, everything's relative. Again, a general statement. It's just always refreshing to be able to have a mature, thoughtful discussion without attacking or having to win or crush.
Yes, it is refreshing. Did I write this right? Dennis Prager?
Yes.
I've heard that name, but I...
Oh, yeah. He's been on the radio for 35 years. He's out of Los Angeles. He has Prager University, which he began, 8 years ago. It's a virtual university, 5-minute videos. YouTube likes to cancel him. Because he dared to put the Ten Commandments out, thou shalt not kill or murder, and they canceled him. I mean, they want to silence him for ridiculous reasons.
Oh, wow. But
I was heavily involved with a club, and there's a whole list of what they call Pragerisms. And there are little things that he says that are just fraught with wisdom. He's a very wise, kind soul.
Yeah, I think I was listening to something with Alison Armstrong and him.
Oh, yes.
Not too long.
He has her on 4 times a year.
Yeah. Yeah, well, agreed. Everything you said. Awesome thoughts. Always love the extra wisdom from Miss Kate here. Yeah, I mean, can't really say much more than I'm in total agreement. And, you know, that's why we're here, you know, that's why we're talking about leadership. You know, it requires people out there doing things a little bit differently and, you know, taking a stand or you know, willing to have a conversation, discussion, argument, conflict differently. And so my hope is that these tools will empower you to do so. You know, so we can make a change out there as far as, and this one does boggle my mind or I wrestle with this one just because of the rate at which things happen on the internet now. And like you said, Kate, the people can hide behind Twitter messages and things of that nature, and just your phone. I mean, like, you know, you don't have to answer it. You don't have to respond to a text message. You don't have, you know, so that's where it kind of starts, and it's only exacerbated by social media. But yeah, I don't know. It's something that I think about a lot as far as what needs to happen as far as having a change like this on a grand level, you know what I mean?
Well, I think there's a sorting that's going on, a filtering that's going on in choices that people are going to kind of come up for air after a lot of non-normal things for the last 18, 24 months. And it's a decision time for where you're going to spend your time, how you're going to treat people, whether you're going to grow and learn, whether you want to give back. There's just a whole host of choices that we get to make in order to create a happy life, a kind life, a loving life, you know, one that has value and not, you know, instant passionate, you know, appetite being fed. You know, I think that technology has offered the speed and the satiation of, you know, fast and instant, and lots of bells and whistles and lights. And now, whether it's, you know, to satiate any appetite that you've got, but, unfortunately, there's muscles that aren't being used, and that's not really the physical that I'm talking about, though that's part of it. But There are critical thinking muscles that are being used. There's delayed pleasure that's not being used. There's patience is not being used. So we've got a lot of flabby emotional muscles that are playing into, what it is we want. And you know, I liken a lot of my clients to two-year-old brats. I, me, me, now, now, want. And at two, you start to get that awful word thrown at you. It's called no. And up to that point, you're handed everything because you're kind of helpless. But at two, you have to start learning and mastering that the world isn't all around you. Well, unfortunately, I think, you know, Kate's philosophy, I believe that we have a lot of two-year-olds running around this country and this world right now, and they're in adult bodies. They're running businesses, they're running governments, they're on, you know, social media, and they really think that they have something of value to offer. So much of it is about control, and it's not about learning or growing or being mature or patient. So, you know, there's going to be a sorting out. There already is. I think a lot of people are dropping social media or really curbing it down and going back to relationships that are not based on virtual. So here we are, you know, in a virtual.
So kind of like a pendulum kind of thing, will swing back the other way.
Yeah, my own beliefs is I think something has to explode first, but we don't need to go down that rabbit hole.
Yes, we can. Well, maybe we'll create a separate live chat for that.
Yeah. I'll just finish with one thing that helps me tremendously because I'm around people who don't agree with me almost all the time. You know, whether it's clients or, you know, my spiritual beliefs or, you know, my political beliefs or any of that. And that is, I love to ask questions. And if I'm authentic and I'm genuine, then I'm obviously looking to understand more. And I'm asking the question not to win, not to change, but to understand and to acknowledge I care about what you're saying. So it does help me in my business, but it helps me as much, you know, with personal relationships. It just taking the time to care and to probe further at something somebody says, I heard you, I'm interested, tell me more.
Love it. Love it. I was going to say something. I just forgot what it was, though. Any other questions? We got 6 minutes till the top of the hour here, but I appreciate it, Kate. Awesome thoughts. Much to think about. Let me check here.
I'm just going to throw in. The I guess masculine side of things that I tend to fall into. I don't know if we have enough time, but
throw it out there.
There's the fixer when you run into people in situations like that that comes out, and you know it doesn't always work as far as being the fixer, but trying to lead in that situation certainly become challenging when you want to kind of help people understand that whole, you know, kind is always better than right. When we have a certain agenda that they're pushing, that, yeah.
Puts a
test.
Are you referring to the masculine drive to solving problems and not?
Yes.
Yes, that is quite the one to throw out with 5 minutes left. But yeah, you're absolutely right, Dave. And what Dave's referring to is when you look at, you know, masculine feminine dynamic or IQ EQ dynamic, generally speaking, an IQ approach. Trying to solve a problem linearly, point A to point B, you know, And to put it in a relationship sense again, if the opposite side or an EQ-based person or a feminine person is more in an emotional space, you know, expressing how they feel, not necessarily looking to solve a problem in that moment, but just, you know, to, for someone to hold space and love them through. Yeah, that can also create a little bit more, you know, friction, or I don't know if, I mean, I guess you could call it a conflict, maybe conflict of interest, but certainly sometimes it can't help. You know, it's just not the mental space that an EQ or feminine person is in at that moment. They're, you know, it's like someone who thinks, more mosaically, or is more of an intuitive, and you try to force them into logically explaining how something works. It's very challenging. It's not so. I think that's what you're referring to, Dave. Is that right?
Yeah, for sure. And that's when your awareness needs to kick in and make sure that you're approaching it the best way, right?
Correct. And yeah, back to getting in the person's model of the world or understanding who you're interacting with serves you greatly. You know, that's, it's kind of the gold standard, or the, you know, one thing. I said kind versus right was the one thing, but when you're, and even just everything that, you know, Kate just mentioned, just consciousness about the context or who you're interacting with, and, you know, the purpose or the intention of the discussion, and, you know, all these things kind of blend together and are connected. But I just can't say enough about getting into someone's model of the world and how you do that. I mean, it is not something that, you know, this might actually be a great topic for our next, you know, our upcoming webinars. We could spend a ton of time on this one alone, but it's something that you want to do. You want to have as your own intention and purpose as a leader, you know, whether it's here or elsewhere through your own resources. Just understand not only others as better than they understand themselves, but understanding yourself too, having, you know, your own self-consciousness. That's funny. Self-awareness about how you're interacting with someone. Maybe you think that you're coming off, or, you know, presenting a certain way, but you're not being received that way. So understanding your own model of the world is also very crucial to this. So another great point, Dave. Appreciate that. Anything else you want to add on that?
No, that's great. It's perfect.
Well, I've got almost 7 o'clock. We started a few minutes late. I'll take any other questions if anyone has any burning ones or wants to throw in another comment. Now's your chance. All right, folks. Well, always appreciate your time. Thanks for being here. Great shares, comments. We'll be back next week. I'm considering to, just so everyone here is aware, I'm going to start experimenting with some other webinar times, maybe do a lunch one here and there if anyone wants to throw some support for that here, let me know. But yeah, I mean, we've been doing 6 o'clock Tuesday nights for so long now. I'd like to see how other times of day work for people, but we'll continue. We'll be on next week at some point.
Thank you, Brian.
Thanks, Brian.
Thanks, everybody.
We'll follow you.
All right. Sounds good. Have a great night. Bye, everyone. Nobody watched.